sense. And Williams now, Williamson. We tend to see your last name as Swedish, Williamson.
Okay, that's fine.
One of the most interesting presentations this year was made by Ben, I think. And he is one of the interesting scholars around big data, data surveillance in schools, a lot of these things that we are now talking about in Sweden, learning analytics, and all of these things around coding and how it's got into the school curriculum. And that's why we invited you to let us be introduced to this question of programming and coding in schools. So, the floor is yours.
Okay, thank you very much. Good morning. This still behind me is the key moment in the popular American drama series Homeland from earlier this year, which some of you may have watched. And at this particular scene, a group of talented young computer programmers are finally launching a new software system they've created. And you can see their arms in the air, and you can almost hear their cheers before their boss says to them, "Now it's time to get to work." But what is this? What have they created in this kind of darkened software bunker? And what is the work that they're being asked to put their coding skills to? Well, this is what Homeland's creators call a propaganda boiler room. So driven by extremist political convictions, these young programmers have created thousands of fake social media accounts, which they're going to use to spread disinformation into the news feeds of millions of users. Now, as many of you will have heard recently, the role of the web and of social media sites in particular in political life and in everyday life have now become major global concerns, not just the plots of TV drama. So we're hearing more and more in the news about fake news, about hacking, cyber attacks, political bots, and even weaponized computational propaganda. And among critical technology thinkers too, we're hearing that, for example, software is taking command, that automation and algorithms now rule the world, and that as a result you can either program or be programmed. So digital technologies, we're now learning, aren't just neutral tools, they're powerful devices for shaping our actions, for influencing how we feel, for changing our minds about things, for filtering the information we receive when we search, for perhaps even automating aspects of some of our jobs, for recommending products and media which we might like to consume, even for manipulating our political convictions and for personalizing what and how we learn in classrooms too. But as Homeland also dramatizes, if this software is becoming more powerful in our everyday and political lives, then we also need to acknowledge that there are people behind it. There are programmers who have themselves learned to code in order to make the technologies that we live with. So within our own field, education and teaching, some have already begun to suggest that we need to equip children and young people with the tools and the skills required to take an active part in this increasingly kind of software-supported, partly automated world. So for example, recently the Financial Times ran this piece on Silicon Valley's classrooms of the future. Having disrupted the world, it claimed, the tech community now wants to prepare children for their new place in it. Leading venture capitalist Mark Andreessen, for example, predicts a world with two types of job: people who tell computers what to do and people who are told what to do by computers. Silicon Valley wants to equip young people to rule the machines. And as a result, Silicon Valley companies are now investing literally billions of dollars to re-engineer aspects of public education to achieve that very aim. So one such effort, according to this piece in the New York Times, is the Learning to Code organization, code.org. Code.org is a major non-profit group financed with more than $60 million from Silicon Valley companies, which has the stated goal of getting every public school in the United States to teach computer science. And its argument, says the author of the piece, is twofold. Students would benefit from these classes, and companies need more programmers. But it's not just in Silicon Valley, of course, that this enthusiasm for teaching children to rule the machines has taken hold. Across the world, children are being told that they must learn to code. In the UK, for example, my home country, learning to code and computer science are slightly different things I'll explore a bit later, but learning to code and computer science are now part of the formal curriculum for schools. In England, in Scotland, where I live, and in Wales too. And over the last couple of years, in my own research, what I've been doing is studying some of the documents that have been produced to promote coding in schools, following how coding and computing have become embedded in the curriculum over there, and also most recently I've been interviewing some of the relevant policy influencers who've been involved in getting computing into the curriculum, particularly in England. So I'm talking about the English case here today. Now, as I understand it, Sweden is embarking on its own shift to embed coding and computing and digital competence in its schools. So I want to explore what we might learn from how things have worked out in England so far. And in our recent interviews, what we've been asking is, why do various influencers want computer programming in schools? Asking the kinds of questions that Neil suggested might be important. What are, in other words, the purposes of embedding learning to code in the curriculum? Or coding for what? Now, we need to go back in time just a little bit here to 2011 and Edinburgh, and we're going to tell something of the narrative of what's happened in England as a way, hopefully, of then thinking about the implications of shifts here. So here at the Edinburgh Television Festival in 2011 is Eric Schmidt, then chief executive of Google. And he was giving the keynote to an audience of media, industry, and policy leaders. So after talking about how Google was going to disrupt TV through media streaming, Schmidt suddenly and unexpectedly turned his attention to attacking the British education system. In the 1980s, he said, the BBC not only broadcast programming for kids about coding, but shipped over a million BBC microcomputers into schools and homes. That, he said, was a fabulous initiative, but it's long gone into the cupboard, as Neil said earlier. I was flabbergasted to learn that today computer science isn't even taught as standard in UK schools. Your IT curriculum focuses on teaching how to use software, but gives no insight into how it's made. That is just throwing away your great computing heritage. Now, this speech really tapped into a growing concern in the UK at the time that teaching children how to use Microsoft Office applications was, frankly, inadequate to preparing them for living and working with more complex computer systems. And in fact, within 6 months of Eric Schmidt's speech in Edinburgh, the Secretary of State for Education in England at the time, Mr. Michael Gove, announced a complete reform of IT education during his own speech at a 2012 EdTech trade show. It was, in fact, the BET show of 2012. And again, here's from his speech. I'm announcing today that the Department for Education is withdrawing the existing National Curriculum Programme of Study for ICT from September this year. The traditional approach would have been to keep the programme of study in place for the next 4 years while we assemble a panel of experts and wrote a new ICT curriculum. We will not be doing that. Technology in schools will no longer be micromanaged by Whitehall. So given that, what on earth happened? Well, despite Gove's argument that they weren't going to micromanage the new curriculum, by September 2013, this is just 20 months later, ICT was gone, and it was replaced with entirely new programs of study for this new subject of computing. This applied at all stages across the national curriculum compulsory schooling in England. Now, I'm going to fill in some of the gaps in the story in a minute, but if we just briefly come back to the present, we now find that Google are much more positive about British education. So this building here is Google's proposed new London headquarters, the enormous land scraper building that it plans to start constructing next to King's Cross railway station in central London next year. It's as long as London's tallest skyscraper is high. And on its announcement last November, the new Google chief executive, Sundar Pichai, said, "Here at the UK, it is clear to me that computer science has a great future with the talent, educational institutions, and passion for innovation we see all around us. We are committed to the UK and excited to continue our investment." So in 5 years, Google really reversed its opinion of computing in the UK and even of the role of its educational institutions in supporting that. Now, you have probably detected something of the theme I'm developing here. Programming and computing in education is something of a shared agenda of major global commercial firms on the one hand and national government departments and policymakers anxious to make changes on the other. So one of the interviewees we spoke to about this said, "Would we have got the attention of Michael Gove without Google or without Microsoft's government relations? I don't think we would. We wouldn't have reached that level of policy making." This is one of the people who was involved in drafting these new programs, explicitly articulating that the involvement of these commercial organizations was very, very powerful in galvanizing political support. But actually, what's happened in England is not as straightforward as business driving policy. What happens in England is a much kind of messier mix of ambitions and activities, which includes government and businesses, but also professional societies, venture capitalists, think tanks, charities, non-profit organizations, the media, and campaigning groups. So as another one of the people we interviewed said, although from the outside the new curriculum looked sudden and organized, it was actually a more anarchic mess of passions and different reasons. So, for example, the year before Eric Schmidt's speech in Edinburgh, the campaigning organization Computing at School had already produced its own white paper detailing a new approach to computing teaching in schools. So Computing at School is a teacher members organization that was originally set up by Microsoft and is chaired by a senior Microsoft executive, but its membership is all ICT and computing teachers. So its 2010 white paper focused specifically on how computers work, the knowledge and skills of programming, and what it called computational thinking. And it described computational thinking as a philosophy that underpins computing and a distinctive way to tackle problems, to break them down into solvable chunks and devise algorithms to solve them in a way that a computer can understand. Now, this computing white paper with those recommendations and the outline curriculum that it contained was then taken to Michael Gove as a suggested blueprint for the new national curriculum subject. So computing at school, we were told in an interview, was concerned that this decision by Michael Gove not to micromanage the new subject would lead to an implementation vacuum. And computing at school therefore worked very hard to lobby for the vision it had developed. As we were told in one of our interviews, the Department for Education held consultation meetings for the ICT curriculum. I went to one. Afterwards, I stayed behind to talk to the civil servant involved and told him about computer science as a school subject. I was able to put our curriculum on the table. It was a complete revelation to them. And it led to a relationship with the Department for Education, who went from thinking of us as a weird guerrilla group with special interests to a group they could consult with about computing. And in fact, it was then the computing at school chairperson, an executive at Microsoft, who was then appointed by the Department for Education to oversee the development of these new programs of study. And that took place through a three-month process of stakeholder consultation and drafting of the new curriculum in autumn 2012. I did say 3 months. It was a three-month process to come up with a new programs of study for an entirely new subject in the national curriculum. However, it wasn't just computing at school that were influencing how this new subject was being developed. One of the other influences is this organization called Nesta. And Nesta is a bit like a think tank for public services in the UK. And also works hard to lobby government around some of its key ideas. So in 2011, Nesta oversaw the production of this report called Next Gen. And Next Gen was a review of the skills requirements for the video games and visual effects industries in the UK. This review was led by the digital entrepreneur Ian Livingston. At the time, Livingston was the chair of Eidos Interactive Games Company and was also the government's skills champion. And Livingston actually described the report as a complete bottom-up review of the whole education system relating to games. Now, Nesta's also produced a report on the legacy of the BBC Micro. This was what Schmidt had described as such a fabulous initiative in the 1980s. And Nesta's also produced a number of additional reports, one on digital making in schools, and another more recently on the role of computer science education in securing the right skills for the data analytics industry and the data-driven economy, which are seen as growth areas in the UK. Now, soon after this NextGen report was released, Livingston and Nesta actually formed a campaigning group to support it, which they called the NextGen Skills Campaign. And again, like computing at school, it lobbied government hard to get computing and computer science in the curriculum. It had the support of Google, Facebook, Nintendo, Microsoft, and this campaign was led by the Interactive Games and Entertainment Trade Body, UKIE. So, video games, visual effects, data analytics, the creative digital economy, these are the real drivers for computing in the curriculum according to this vision, which Nesta claims has influenced policymakers, rallied industry, and galvanized educators to improve computer science teaching. Ian Livingston, the figurehead of the report, meanwhile, is now setting up his own academy schools. So this is somewhat like the Swedish free schools approach. So the Livingston Academies will be privately run by Livingston and his partners, but publicly funded, and have significant discretion over the curriculum. Livingston said, "It's the combination of computer programming skills and creativity by which today's world-changing companies are built." This was in a press release announcing the academies for the Department for Education. "I encourage other digital entrepreneurs to seize the opportunity offered by the Free Schools Programme in helping give children an authentic education for the jobs and opportunities of the digital world. So these Livingston Academies that Livingston himself is now setting up are basically government-approved, publicly funded models of the next-gen vision based on a review of the video games industry's skills needs. These schools will have their own industry partnerships, they'll have design studios, and they'll even have their own on-site startup business hubs to provide wider opportunities for future careers, it says. So Nesta and Livingston together have highlighted the powerful role of digital entrepreneurs and the language of the digital economy in securing government approval for computing in schools, basically. Their emphasis is very firmly on programming and software engineering rather than on the more abstract study of the mathematics and algorithms that are the focus of the discipline of computer science. And although programming and computer science are, of course, related, many critics have pointed out that most new computing courses and curricula, like the one in the UK, seem more closely related to software development rather than disciplinary computer science itself. So we asked people about this in our interviews. What's the difference? Why have we got different perspectives here? And we were told by several people we interviewed that it was actually in everyone's best interests to allow terms like computer science, coding, programming, computational thinking, digital skills, and even digital literacy to be treated as the same thing. It helped everybody to achieve their aims through talking a shared language. And several people we interviewed were actually especially critical of this report, Shut Down or Restart was the name of the report, that was produced by the Royal Society, a kind of ancient learned society of scientists, in 2012. So the emphasis of the Royal Society was on very much on disciplinary computer science, and its recommendations reflected the views of computer science academics and their associations. Now, their report was published just a few days after Michael Gove's speech. In fact, Michael Gove said he was very much looking forward to reading it when he announced that he was scrapping ICT. And you can see the influence now of the Royal Society in a kind of strong emphasis that we now have in England, in addition to the digital economy angle, but a strong emphasis on computing as the fourth science in English education. And this goes well with a kind of a current emphasis we have in the UK on kind of established subject knowledge. So there's a kind of, at the same time, we're juggling with the idea of computing as a hard science and as a kind of economic productivity catalyst at the same time. Okay, so in fact, we were told by several interviewees that a major issue in the development of this new computing curriculum back in 2012-2013 was that the government ministers and their special advisors who were responsible for this actually didn't think that it was academic enough. When the first consultations had taken place and drafts were produced, they argued it needed more hard computer science content and theory, though of course they weren't supposed to be micromanaging this. So when the computing curriculum consultation group submitted a draft in late 2012, they received this response. The exact words, this is what we were told in an interview, were that the minister is not minded to approve the draft you sent. This group so had submitted its draft curriculum by the deadline it had been set of 5 o'clock on a Friday evening shortly before Christmas. The chair of the group was then contacted over the weekend by the special advisor to the minister responsible for this. So one of the people we interviewed then said how on the Monday morning, when he found out about this, he called the working group chair to ask, so are we going to reform the drafting group? And the answer was, he said, no, we've already done it. We were told unless we got it back to the minister by 9 o'clock on Monday morning, with a greater emphasis on computer science, then computing would not be in the national curriculum at all. So despite this consultative process of curriculum drafting, which involved many different stakeholders from different organisations and teacher representatives, in the end, the new programmes of study that we've got were the product primarily of just two senior executives responding directly to the demands of the minister and her special advisor to emphasise more academic computer science. And for many of the people that have been involved in this group, the point was really not to reproduce disciplinary computer science or skills development for the digital economy either. So one of the people we interviewed, who was also part of this curriculum consultation and drafting group, told us that he was even banned from attending the meetings after he'd complained about there already being too much computer science content. Another interviewee told us he had his expenses cancelled as part of the group to stop him doing wider consultation with teachers. The minister's special advisor was allegedly behind both of these decisions. Now, another area of influence on the computing curriculum, because there are lots of influence on it, and another one, was the role of charitable, non-profit, and voluntary groups, like Code Club. And Code Club is an after-school programming scheme that puts volunteer programmers together with children to teach them how to code. So it itself has its own coding curriculum. It starts with visual programming applications like Scratch, provided by MIT, and then proceeds through programming languages like HTML, CSS, and Python. And there are now over 5,000 code clubs in the UK, teaching over 82,000 children programming. Now, when it first started, 5 years ago, in 2012, we didn't yet have this computer curriculum that we now have. Despite us now having this curriculum, Code Club and it being taught in schools, Code Club is still going incredibly strong. I think what this indicates, its enduring popularity indicates, is that computing remains quite poorly resourced in our schools. Code Club has an army of volunteer programmers to work with children. The computing curriculum in schools has a teaching workforce of mostly ICT teachers who now all need radical retraining to get up to speed with what has been rushed in to replace it. Now, the government did budget fairly, in fairness, for this retraining, but that budget worked out to about £100 per member of staff. I don't know what that is in krona, but £100 for retraining a member of staff is really a pittance. This means that a number of external providers have now had to step in to provide the knowledge and the skills that teachers require. So, Code Club itself now runs a teacher training scheme where volunteer programmers educate teachers in how to teach programming. And of course, other training providers are available. So Computing at School offers resources and classes. Google has a suite of resources that it offers for free to school. And there are a range of other organizations involved in this as well. Code Club was also absorbed late in 2015 into the Raspberry Pi Foundation. Now, I'm sure many of you have heard of Raspberry Pi. It's a small, portable, hackable computer about the size of a credit card. The Raspberry Pi Foundation specifically was set up as a charity to support the educational uses of the Raspberry Pi. Now, one of the key roles performed by Raspberry Pi is to sort of catalyse this wider take-up of computing in schools, and it has a couple of magazines to do this, the Magpie and Hello World. Now, the Magpie is specifically about making with the Raspberry Pi, but Hello World here, which it just released recently, focuses on what it calls plugging gaps in teachers' knowledge and skills in computer science, coding, computational thinking, constructionism, and digital making, all of which are referenced on the front cover of this first edition of the magazine. Again, this reflects some of the kind of ambiguity in the terms that are being used here to describe what's going on in schools. Now, probably the most high-profile intervention that we've now had is the BBC's nationwide campaign, Make It Digital, which it launched in 2015 and is ongoing now. So it claims BBC Make It Digital will capture the spirit of the BBC Micro from the 1980s, which helped Britain get to grips with the first wave of personal computers. It will put digital creativity in the spotlight like never before and help build the nation's digital skills through an ambitious range of new programs, partnerships, and projects. And one of the key projects was this, the MicroBit, another small coding device, rather like the Raspberry Pi, which the BBC developed in partnership with a range of hardware partners, and then distributed for free to 1 million UK school children about this time last year. And the BBC has now also established its own non-profit foundation to roll out the MicroBit internationally. So the MicroBit, Code Club's courses, Raspberry Pi's magazines, indicate, I think, how much this new curriculum that we're now getting to grips with in England relies on public and charitable organisations to provide the support and resources required when government decides to withdraw its micromanagement of key subject areas. This, I think, you know, this is a sort of model case of how education policy is being done these days. So it's being steered by government, but being taken forward by much kind of wider networks of organisations, with these special advisors taking a strong role in steering what's going on. So it's not micromanaged, as Michael Gove said, but it's not unmanaged either. And that makes it quite difficult to work out what the overall purpose of this new curriculum is, because it means different things to a range of different people. And that means things get missed out. So the missing aspect of this curriculum, as I see it anyway, is this more questioning or critical understanding of the kind of social power of computing. Now, several of the people we interviewed said that the more critical aspects of computing that had been suggested might be important during the original consultation process were systematically erased before the curriculum programmes of study were finally made public in 2013. So I know it's small, but take a look at this table. This is compiled by Peter Twining, who has shared this very publicly. He was part of the consultation group. In the bottom left, you can see that some text has been scrubbed out. And this is text from that original draft curriculum that was submitted in 2012. And it emphasized critical evaluation of digital content, the impacts of technology on individuals and society, and the implications of technologies for rights, responsibilities, and freedoms. The right-hand column, with some text in red, which you can't really make out, but the right-hand column shows how this part of the draft was rewritten and now emphasizing the study of algorithms, Boolean logic, and data manipulation. This is what was lost when the curriculum got revised and rewritten between being submitted on a Friday after a public consultation and then the new deadline of 9 o'clock on a Monday morning that had been specified. Now, I understand that here in Sweden there might be more scope for more kind of questioning, critical approaches to digital competence. So I want to spend the last few minutes focusing on that, really. Now, just a week or so ago, the Austrian research group, Cracked Labs, produced a really interesting report on the commercial data industry. And it demonstrated in a variety of graphs and lengthy text how we're being tracked and profiled every day via data collected from our use of telecoms, the media, retail, finance, social media, and technology platforms, and public services, including education too. And one of the examples in the report is Oracle, one of the world's largest business software and database vendors. So Oracle's data cloud, that it can now compile from its vast partnered network, its cloud contains detailed information about 2 billion people, which it then uses to profile and sort, find and target, personalize, measure how people behave, and sell data. So what does this have to do with computing in schools? Well, last year, just before Christmas, December 2016, Oracle announced that it was going to fund European Union member states $1.4 billion to advance computing in program and programming in schools through Oracle Academy, its global philanthropic arm. So this is part of Oracle's ambition to spread computer science education around the world, and it already claims to have impacted on 30 million students in 110 countries, mostly through retraining teachers. And it annually invests $3.3 billion to do this. So notably, in Europe, what Oracle's going to do is it wants to level its entire curriculum in computer science to the European qualifications framework, a kind of standard framework of qualifications that cuts across EU member states. So this makes Oracle potentially very influential in European computing education. In fact, a European Union spokesperson said of this deal, "Digitally skilled professionals are critical to Europe's competitiveness and capacity for innovation. Over the last 10 years, we've seen the demand for workers with computer science and coding skills grow by 4% each year. Oracle's efforts to bring computer science into classrooms across the European Union will help strengthen our digital economy." So, one of the world's most powerful data harvesting companies is also one of the world's most powerful coding in schools education providers, funding one of the world's most powerful cross-national digital economies. Well, that's how it sees it. Now, for me, this Oracle example is an important one that we can learn from because it captures, I think, quite a lot of what's going on with coding and computing more broadly. So first, coding and computer science are being put forward as solutions to the digital economy by businesses, but also by think tanks and by government officials, with students being positioned as future digital workers and entrepreneurial citizens, agents of social and economic progress through software, if you like. Secondly, relationships are now being built between national governments and commercial companies to deliver on these kinds of major educational goals and purposes. This is changing how education systems are governed. This is not just governance by government departments, but from the headquarters and the philanthropic outgrowths of major technology companies. It's an example of how tech companies, many of them from Silicon Valley in California, are becoming shadow education ministries, as Neil described them in his last book. And third, and as a consequence, companies like Oracle, as well as Google and Microsoft, are now directly influencing curricula across Europe and beyond. They're changing what teachers practice and what students learn along the way. They're actively supplying teacher training courses to equip teachers with the skills and knowledge to do it. And fourth, these organizations are talking the language of computer science, which is appealing to policymakers, but what they're actually promoting is possibly closer to software engineering. So they're shaping computing to be a more practical, skills-based subject area, and definitely not the more critically focused subject, which might itself draw attention to the kind of data harvesting and surveillance practiced, being practiced by the same organisations that are now persuading governments to focus on computing education in schools. Okay, so this Cracked Labs report shows that these kind of companies know an awful lot about people. And for me, this indicates the kind of digital environment that young people are now living and learning in. And that's why, just in closing, I want to suggest the need for perhaps a different direction, or at least a proper discussion about the purposes of computing and coding in schools. And it's really great to see this conference as a space where that dialogue might begin here in Sweden. So we are teaching kids to code now in many different countries, and this does have all sorts of potential advantages in terms of technology skills, creativity, understanding how computers work. I see these as important things worth focusing on in schools. But we need to be aware that there's a danger of reproducing the kind of valued practices of Silicon Valley in our own classrooms. So the philosopher of technology, Ian Bogost, has said, not all students in computer science programs think they'll become startup billionaires, but not all of them don't think so either. Would-be engineers are encouraged to think of every project as a potential business ready to scale and sell. It's also notable that when the co-founder of Code Club criticized the mass surveillance practices of Google a few years ago, she was forced to resign by the Code Club board. Google was at that time one of Code Club's main commercial sponsors. We should not accept that privacy no longer exists just because corporations doing mass surveillance also teach kids to code, she said. Okay. I think we also need to think about the political uses of programming. Unless we get some of the critical stuff right, coding could in fact be a little dangerous. We could be teaching them with the kind of skills they require to go and work in Homeland's propaganda boiler room. So some critics are already arguing that learning to code is actually a distraction from learning values filters to interact in this environment. So a meaningful computing education might need to engage with this social and political power of code to engineer in part how we live and think. We had this headline in a magazine for teachers in the UK last week, which said the algorithm's going to get you in the classroom. It's about all the new kind of data analytics, learning analytics in the classroom. It's, of course, an overly paranoid headline, but maybe it might be useful in provoking more educators to consider the social power of programming and the kind of techniques that have been produced as a result. So technical know-how in computing has its uses, but also knowing about things like privacy, data protection, how news circulates online, cyber attacks, hacking, understanding something about bots, algorithms, automation, and how they're affecting the future of work, and knowing that there are programmers and business plans and political agendas and interest groups behind all of this. This seems to me worth including a meaningful computing education too. I'm encouraged to see that there is scope to have a kind of more honest dialogue about the purposes of computing in the curriculum here in Sweden. Tack.